Hi. Hi, welcome to the Poetry Project. Yeah, you can woo. I'm Kyle DeQuyen. I'm the executive director here. I'm really excited for this. It's amazing to be with you for this celebration of a first book. It's a first book for Rachel Mannheimer. It's a first book for changes. This is a book so deeply about place, and we also endeavor to begin all of our events with some acknowledgement of this particular complex place where we are. Our venue, St. Mark's Church, is situated on the unceded homelands of the Lenape people, and it is actually the site where Peter Stuyvesant built his family chapel in 1660. So if you were to walk through the cemeteries on both sides of this church, you would find that Stuyvesant and many of the colonizing families whose names we recognize by street and subway stop are buried here. And you will find at the entrance of the church the known names of people enslaved by those families, many of whom built unwillfully the original chapel. So we want to center accountability, repair, and transparency as we acknowledge this history and the land we occupy. And we want to emphasize that language of acknowledgement is incomplete without substantive divestment and action. Something I really love about this book, Earth Room, is Rachel's attention to these sorts of spaces and how their lineages and histories are acknowledged or ignored, and how the social dynamics of these spaces, literary, artistic, performance experiences, get introduced and maintained. What's valorized or chintzy or sincere about their surfaces, and also what's happening subtextually or at the margins or in secret. What radiates relationally from our encounters with art. Culture feels sometimes like a sausage factory and sometimes like space exploration. The market and romance can be equally true conditions. I think this book holds opposition with frankness and vulnerability, also with beauty, a suspicion of beauty, a beautiful simultaneity of distance and intensity. I'm excited that we're going to hear these poems in the voices and correspondences of different friends tonight. My thanks to Maggie Millner, Jenny Shia, and Terrance Hayes, who will read in that order, and of course to Rachel Mannheimer, who will read at the end. And now I want to thank and also congratulate and introduce Bennett Bergman for a few more words about this book and also about changes.
Thank you so much, Kyle. Thank you all for being here with us tonight to celebrate Rachel's book. I'm Bennett Bergman. I'm the publisher. Earth Room is the first title to be published by Changes, and it's also the inaugural winner of this thing called the Bergman Prize, which will be awarded annually from now on for a first or second collection of poems. I started the prize in memory of my parents. Everyone in my family in some way or another was or is an artist, and I feel really fortunate to have had parents who really encouraged each of us in our creative lives and pursuits. So I think of the prize as a continuation of that spirit of encouragement that they modeled for me and my siblings growing up. And if there's anyone to thank for making all of this possible, it's them. It's really all for and because of them. Thanks. In the early days when we were just beginning to run advertisements for the prize, it was really scary because we were publicly totally committed to awarding this prize for someone's manuscript, but we had no idea whether anyone was going to even send their book to this prize that no one had ever heard of. So it was a tremendous help, and of course we are very grateful to have been able to work with the judge of Louise Glück's stature in the first year, and we were really overjoyed to find that in fact lots of people submitted, and we ended up receiving an incredible volume of really exciting work. And then there was Earthroom, this finished book, this gorgeous, really compelling book-length poem. And now that it's being released into the world, it occurs to me not only that things have gone could have gone very differently, but that really we couldn't have asked for a stronger beginning to this prize series. So as much as this prize is meant as a gift of support to the winning poet, I want to acknowledge the feeling of immense gratitude that I have for Rachel for trusting us with such a stunning, strong book, one that I think does a great deal to elevate the work of our young press and to lend credibility to this new prize. And apart from that, it's a joy and a privilege to be able to work with such a kind person and a great poet who's clearly much beloved in her community. So I feel very fortunate. Thank you, Rachel. And there are a lot of other people who made this possible. So I ought to take a minute to thank them too. I want to thank our amazing first readers for the prize, Sandra Lim, Jenny George, and Janelle Effiwat. Thank you to Vance Wellenstein for his beautiful design, and to Yvonne Rayner for lending us her artwork for the cover. I'd like to thank Alan Felsenthal for his guidance, Coco Fitterman and Makiko Woli, Jonathan Galassi, J.C. Gable, Sybil Perez, Allison Sinclair, and my husband, Oren Panassi. And thank you to Terrance Hayes, Jenny Shia, and Maggie Millner, Robin Schiff for writing about this book, and to those of you who are here to read tonight. Finally, really, thank you, Kyle DeQueen and the Poetry Project staff and volunteers. It's been really exciting, I think, to watch Kyle and his team shape this chapter of the Poetry Project's important legacy. It feels like a great honor to be invited into this space to celebrate the launch of our first book. So thank you for having us and for all that you're doing to support poetry. And with that, I will hand things off to the evening's first reader, Maggie Millner.
I'm so happy to be here. It's such an honor to be celebrating the birthday of Earthroom, which is sincerely the best book of poetry I've read in a very long time, and to be reading with such formidable poets who I admire so much. I feel very moved, and I feel very, very grateful to be here. So thank you to Changes, and thank you to the Poetry Project, and thank you and congrats to Rachel. I'm going to start with a poem from Earthroom, which I think speaks really beautifully to what Kyle was, some of the things that Kyle was saying about the book, Tempelhof. It's like the mountains, Chris said about the open field. It was flat, like a track, had been a city airport. And when you ran, you could always see how far you had to go. There weren't many trees, and it was late for leaves, but there were birds. The hooded crows were new to me, hooded, I guess, for the black that covered their heads, but it was the gray down their bellies and their backs that was distinct. They hopped around the baseball diamond near first base. Darkly, I had joked about the barbed wire curling along the top of a nearby wall, but there actually was a camp here. Forced labor for Lufthansa. 11 were killed in a Pittsburgh synagogue the morning we flew out. The sanctuary where I might have prayed with Zev. I told him once I hated him, stayed with him 2 more months. All around Berlin, there was considered signage about history. I stopped under the banner for the home team, Berlin Braves, stern face with familiar war paint, feathers. The boys on skateboards held surf kites and sailed down the former runway toward the fenced-off section where refugees were housed in modular containers, a container village is what I'd heard it called. Or they landed jumps off granite slabs repurposed for the designated skate park. Beyond the fence, what looked like circus tents. It was warm for November, and women my age draped overcoats over their strollers. Everywhere, people whose judgment I trusted were having kids. My oldest sister had 2 little girls, sometimes slipped and called them by my name. I watched Chris up ahead, now turning, now waiting, jogging in place. I wished Mom could have met him. I held my arms out wide in recognition. We were only in Berlin those 2 gray months and wouldn't see the light come back. We were having trouble waking up, but we were trying to run every day to adjust. It's all that good, in fact. I'm gonna read some poems now from my book, Couplets, which is forthcoming in February of next year. It rhymes, so look out for that. And there's also, it's a book that's about a queer romance on the heels of a long-term straight relationship. So there's a he, the ex-boyfriend, and there's a she, the speaker's current girlfriend. And I'll pause between sections. Everyone had the same IKEA bed. She tied my wrists to hers above my head. She liked what she called clean lines, I'd learn. Her major had been architecture. Sometimes when I lay there waiting, bound or free, I'd envision its assembly, the tiny standard issue wrench that torqued the socket of the bolt, drawing the particle board flush against the rails, the 100 screws, the greasy crossbar with its cues of stapled slats, the wooden dowels, which had seemed too large to fit their holes, that gently she'd forced in, the plastic pegs, the final footboard trussed between the legs. She was also dating someone else. They believed in alternative relationship models, which meant she could keep seeing me, provided I agreed to polyamory and didn't ask for more than my allowance of her time. Our dates she scheduled in advance. The other girlfriend got most Fridays and any night I stayed in grading essays, but Tuesdays and Saturdays were mine. It was equitable by design, though also not exactly democratic. During those months, there was a lot of panic, moral and otherwise, about men and domination, open borders, what precisely was harassment. About sex, I had emphatic, lucid, memorized opinions crusted over a cesspit of dark ambivalence. At parties, I spoke less and less, skewered olives on my tiny cocktail sword. Often when I kissed my lover, I could almost taste the other girl. Her close-cropped hair and longer, cultish legs, her pit sweat and the apricotish dregs of her perfume. Was I not really a bohemian at all? I had thought I had a different heart, one with doors, one that did not love perforce toward the condition of possession. But when she pulled out of me and tossed her harness in a duffel bag with lubricants and toiletries to carry to the other girlfriend's house, I felt rush through my blood a surge of insecurity and dread, and I would retch and clutch myself and weep. This was why I liked to keep two of her fingers in my body while we slept. I wanted her to smell me in her nail beds all day long. One morning, as we said goodbye, I told her that she owned me. I wanted her to say it back, to preface it with only. Now and then, I'd get the strange impression that she was me. A stab of thonic recognition would set off a little spasm in my eye. Sometimes from far away, I'd spy her slanted walk or messy hair, and every muscle in my body would contract. At school, while my students bent over their exams, I'd scroll through photos on her Instagram, the fabric growing damp between my legs where her finger liked to press itself inside me like a key. An undiscovered ancestor, an eidolon, an isomer, and an uncanny sense of unity to love in her what always seemed deformity in me, to yield, to feel the snugness of the fit, to turn the lock, to hear the little click. Other times I could feel myself become him. Those tics I'd found most tiresome, his artificial cheer, his trick of going silent in the heat of conflict, or accusing me of being self-indulgent without ever specifying what he meant, suddenly belonged to me, my temper having lifted in our time together some properties of his. His ideas crowded my head as if through an earpiece. His hand's phantom weight guided my own. His scowl in my mirror and in my microphone, his speech down to the voices, note of spite, the patronizing diagnosis, the words I'd use to scold her when she told a tasteless joke. It was the same old dialectic I had thought I'd left behind. This is partly why I thought I'd lost my mind. But when she'd start to plunge into depression, as I've often done, curled in bed or prostrate on the ground, listing all the people she'd let down, it was by remembering how he had soothed me that I soothed her. And when I held her cheek against my cheek, I was drawing from the well of love he filled. So I became, after all, not him exactly, but a kind of conduit between them, a conversation they conducted with my mouth. And when I was not unbelievably sad, I was moved unbelievably to hold inside me both my lovers and to introduce them to each other, there, in the hollow, just above the heart, among the little folds where the voice starts. And I just have one more, which I have to read off my phone. You could have had everything you wanted, had it been what you wanted. You're cutting through the park at sunset, plane trees, wind, children on the swing set, making the exact sound of humanity. Look how everything moves according to gravity and reaches your perceiving organ according to the qualities of light and oxygen. You bring the apple to your mouth and wish for a little peanut butter to distinguish it. So what? You like what you like. A familiar-seeming man dismounts a bike. Beneath a branch, some birds palaver on, and which you realize now belongs to the very camper down Marianne Moore described. Two elements do not a pattern make. At great cost, you got a sense for what your life could be, and still had to admit that after all, that wasn't really it. Though, okay, it was close. It was on the continuum. This city is absolutely overcome with stories like these, which are the real source of its creepy electricity, the force of its seduction, that and the bagels. You sally forth, practicing your kegels, passing a wedding at the boathouse on the Lull Water, which is deliciously this quarter of the lake's official name, and you will lose again. And no matter what you do, you can't not want. Dip your foot in if you like. Why not? No one is looking. Thank you.
Maggie, that was exquisite and such a feat. I can't wait for couplets. Hi, everyone. I am so, so happy to be gathered here with Maggie, with Terrance, with all of you to celebrate Rachel's extraordinary Earth Room. I have to say, it also feels strange to share something that I feel protective over because I love it so much. It's a work of such luminous complexity and gentle awakenings. And every time I'm inside the poems, I feel that I'm in the presence of a mind whose stillness, whose warm intelligence I really just trust wholly, and whose quality of attention and of looking is a kind of radiant ethics. And that's how it is to be in the presence of Rachel, the person, as well. So congratulations, Rachel. I'll be reading Berlin. Maybe Dan was right. At the Gemälde Gallery, there were so many ways to be a mom, so many babies one could have. Botticelli's sweet, wild-eyed Maria, the infant vain and knowing on her lap. And then these Flemish babies, one a pointed, bleached wood doll, one a hairless cat. Madonna and child in the Maso di Banco regard each other like a fond and fussy couple. He reaches out as though to steal a morsel from her plate. All their sons died young and terribly. Chris, in his orange hat, wandered back from the landscapes to find me. Why should I ever miss her less? It's only ever longer since I've seen her. And I'll read a couple of poems from a forthcoming collection titled The Rupture Tense, and I thought in the spirit of Earth Room, I would contextualize them by the cities in which they're situated or arose from. So this first one is New York City, the early days of quarantine. And writing it, I was thinking about the Japanese conceptual artist on Kawara and his date paintings, of which there are close to 3,000. And some of you may be familiar, these are these rectangular canvases, acrylic on canvas, and at the very center, very starkly, is the date that Kawara painted the painting. And that's it. And they'll be in some sort of wash of blue, red, gray. And the monotony of the paintings kind of belies their rigor and their singularity. He would wake up every morning and draw the date, sometimes in the language of the city he was in, and then he would painstakingly put on layers of paint, and if he didn't finish that day, he would destroy them, and then start anew the next day. And I was very lucky to see a retrospective of his work in 2015 at the Guggenheim, shortly after he passed away, and the scale of it, and you know, they probably only put up hundreds, felt unfathomable, and the scale of a day felt unfathomable. Unit of measure. Time so undifferentiated, its symmetry without a face, without circumference, leapt clean from outline. Here, lid of each day, cream of fool's filling, jump cut after jump cut, and none of the cadence of suture. Measure by measure, those robed in temples bring the breath to the body's surface, their sit bones molded to buckwheat cushions, their spines upright, as if held in suspension by fishing rods. On Kawara, who mixed fresh his reds, blacks, and blues on each day's rim, then set time in its casing with the slim sewing of pencil and then brush. Did he see how weeks soften and lose shape with a ribbon of white fat at the edges? How sleep gathers within the eyes an infection that heals each evening. O motion sickness of the minute hand that came centuries after the hour, trimming the day down to property and to size, to fill time or to decant it, that which must be ingested, undiluted, which passes from my body to yours. This next one is Oaxaca in 2020, maybe the last trip I made before the pandemic. The maid world. Your ear moves along one swarm of conversation to another, then alights on a dog's stiff bark in a cubed cornflower house up the hill. How hard the city center has worked for this. How easily the churches gather with their brushed ribs. Some words tossed off like beads, some pepper cooling on the lip of a bowl. Small glances from afar that one keeps in one's front pockets. Blurry forms are stored elsewhere, in the camera, stacked along streets of ochre and rose. Attention's formidable property. You spend it quickly, crumbling rock with your feet along alleyways, loose couplets. You mistake this opening for waking, but it's a trick of the landscape. We who are made and are made by the dark mass of the unseen. This far inland, emptying out feels both distant and near. This one is somewhere outside of Taos, New Mexico in 2018. Present continuous. In the sweetness of the mountain pass, the severity of lines, thick saguaros, stabs of gold to the east and west of me. Even so, nerves quelled by a dry wind. Truth is, I'm just two brushstrokes, no more, no lesser. Even without a center, I can sense forces urging my life back inside invisible coordinates. The root of forgetting is the constant rebuilding of the interior, is an exhausted sun licking the land clean. Forgive me. I grow sleepless in August, answering to a whistle even I can't hear. Tell me again about the arrogance of the restless. When is it ever enough? Staying still, absorbing the echoing of tenses. And I'll just read one more. This was Shanghai in 2019. And I was returning to my hometown in Wuhu, Anhui province, where I hadn't set foot for 30 years since I left. In search of. It wasn't the knob of sun or grainy currents crossing the eye that invites thought that you've finally arrived at the clearest understanding. This very instant on the Huangpu River, where the mind is serrated, dragging its way. All this thinking. Thousands upon thousands along the river and inland, and still meaning is heavier than the bodies we yoke it to. Surely for this reason, death must announce itself again and again in such sour language, so we may live closer to the senses, the sweat of the unsayable. Moments when we feel history pulling from behind, the eyes, the mouth, hooked. But the remainder of this life is still millions of kilometers away from being born. Thank you.
Thanks, Jenny. It's always good to hear your work. Maggie, it's good to be reading with Rachel. I never think like former student. I mostly think like future peer, you know, like poets that you're gonna be standing here reading with at some point. So I always knew it was gonna happen. Here we are, we'll be here again, you know, it's just the beginning. So, you know, my poem is short. The poem I'm reading from the book, Rochester, is short. On page 59. So what I thought I would do is like read it first and then read my blurb and then read a cento of all the theirs in her book. Or read my poem and then read a cento and then read this poem again and I'll be done. So I just got one poem from me. All right, and then we're gonna hear from Rachel. So this one's called Rochester. It's one of the ones called Rochester. I think the next one's called Rochester. The horse was in the yard. The horse was in its yard, on its side, lying down, legs bent and hooves off the ground. Its mouth, two more horses stood by. This was outside Rochester. It was wrong to measure loss by size, wrong to measure loss by human grief, to see the house cat on the highway as different from a possum or the birds fallen far from the road. It's been so long, I can't even see. Is it the font, Bennett? I should have brought I don't need those reading glasses. It's just been so long. So let me read my blurb that I wrote for her because the poem I think I'm on trial here for the first time feels like the opposite Walter De La Mera, I don't know. Okay, so the blurb I wrote for the book is multiple readings of Rachel Mannheimer's thoroughly fresh debut reward and fascinate like multiple visits to Walter De La Maria's eponymous Earth Room installation, which is, I don't know how many people have seen it, but it is, it's in town. We should do a reading there is what I was suggesting. You should try to set up a reading there. This book is a charismatic travelogue for our interior and exterior landscapes. It's a conceptual art catalog with a poet's notes written in the margins. It's a one-act play of engrossing verbal theater. The stupendous Earth Room makes language a place. It's roomy, it's personal, it's everyday. So I was trying to think about what I would read, like the interior and exterior landscapes. So let's see how this thing goes. I just got this one poem. Bob Ross paints your portrait. Because, you know, he doesn't do portraits. I was like, when I was writing it and reading it to myself, because I've never read it out, I was like, if I read it slowly, it'll make me calm down in the reading of it. So, and it's like how he talks. It was because of the way that he talks that I thought I would be wanting to try to be him. So, all right, here we go. Bob Ross paints your portrait. Today, we're going to get to work on the details of your expression. And believe it or not, the only colors we're going to use will be blacker than most blacks. We'll use a black canvas and just a single finger instead of a brush. So let's take and dab the tip of a pointer finger into the black, like so. And now we're going to cover everything between jawbone and temple, cheek and nostril, lip and eyebrows on both sides of the mouth in black. You folks at home are welcome to use a thumb, use a pinky or pinky toe. I just want to enjoy yourself. Get the feel of the color until it suits you. And just gently tap, tap, gently tap the color into the shape of a forehead. There we go. Maybe like we're touching tiny, tender buttons, gently dabbing and tapping the black in. There we go. We want it all to be approximately the same deep space black, black hole black moving between our canvas and fingertip. gently, barely touching and tapping and touching, layers of fingerprint until we have the look of a deeply textured black, like so. Okay. Now we're going to put some of the past in the background around your mind, all the way out to the edges of the canvas where all kinds of things are happening. In the distance, maybe we'll place a mother and father, but we'll make them mostly visible in your expression. What's so nice about these black canvases is if there's light shining directly on them, they look completely different. It's almost like having two paintings inside of one. The night sky, the soil. Today, we want it all to disappear and appear to disappear. Maybe there's a stretch of love that just sort of graduates into nothing. Maybe there's nothing but waiting. We want to touch gently enough to calm the longing, the boundless beauty bound in you. It's like debating whether water is bluish green or greenish blue before it blackens. Don't spend a lot of time worrying about it. We can begin applying some little black stars in the background without changing our technique very much. Wherever we picture stars, we can just touch the canvas like so. Mm-hmm. We can add black stars for eyes and black stars for scars. We want it all to be as black as the space around a constellation. There we go. And maybe we want to take it and add a little bit of the past. It's happening all the time. Just enough to convey what we're trying to feel, the texture beneath the finger. Okay. Maybe one of your parents is in some way bigger than the other. Maybe one gives you your stinger and the other gives you your shell. So you have to work a little harder to forgive yourself. And we'll just lay in some of your favorite color, which is black, under the blackness. Lamp black and ink black, boot black and blackjack and blacker. Just gently tap, tap, tapping. Now I think I mentioned it earlier, but in case you missed it, if you have any questions or comments or something I can help you with, please feel free to drop me a line. Lay in some blue black, some ivory black, and jet black and blacker. Gently tapping and touching. There we go. I would just love to hear from you. You have all kinds of beautiful depths and layers and shapes of black. Okay. Now we're going to handle your hair like a lovely coat of black feathers. Or it might be a black feather hat or black feather wig or afro or cloud. We'll take our finger and just make little crosses across your crown. Folks trying this at home might want to make big, bold plus signs if you feel bold. Whatever you like. Feathers, the color of hair, the night before it turns gray in the darkness. Feathers, the color of sadness or escape. I can't shake the memory of a woman I loved poorly, curling her finger as if pointing at something inside herself when she showed me how she longed to be touched. Gently make the shape of blackness black. There we go. If we pick up a little bit of the darkness under the color, that's okay. That's just fine. We want to pull the darkness out from the edge and blend it over the curve of your nose, following the curve of your speech, down into the onyx, the gunmetal, the black magic rabbit hat hole of a top hat kind of black, moving between canvas and finger, like so. Like so. Take your time. Soon the darkness stands back from you a little. Everything in the background begins and ends where your body begins and ends. Can you feel yourself emerge as you fall backwards? Wait till you hear what I've got planned for next week. Is who hurt you equal to who you hurt? Is who loves you equal to who you love? We'll start right there and work in the direction of desire. But right now, let's begin working on your shadows. Okay. All of theirs in Earth Room, which says, you know, some of the things we're talking about with place. Don't ask me how I discovered this as I was reading it. I think I probably read the book too many times. I started seeing patterns. So Earth Room Cinto of There. There weren't many trees, and it was late for leaves, but there were birds. There was considered signage about history. There were signs for the Church of the Big Hole. There was a skunk I also watched, though I had thought that skunks preferred the nighttime. There's still some debate about horses. There were two movies that summer about boys and their horses. There's the story of the Earth Art exhibition at Cornell, 1969. Walter De La Maria flew in through a blizzard for the opening. There are other heterosexual antics too, not in the film. There are tables and too many chairs. There's no snow in Ithaca, but I get the idea this is unusual from the shovels and cross-country skis people keep by their front doors. There was grunting and screaming, sounds of climax and labor, all three women, participants now, in a violent sexual frenzy. And one more time, Rochester. The horse was in its yard, on its side, lying down, legs bent and hooves off the ground, its mouth. Two more horses stood by. This was outside Rochester. It was wrong to measure loss by size, wrong to measure loss by human grief, to see the house cat on the highway as different from a possum or the birds falling far from the road. All right, y'all, let's get ready for the star. Rachel, I'm so proud of you.
Thank you so much. A fun fact about Bob Ross is that he used to live in Alaska. Thank you so much to these readers. You were incredible. Thank you to all of you for being here. Thank you to my family, who I think is watching on this live stream. A special thank to Francesca, who came all the way from Anchorage, and happy birthday to Marcel. Thank you for being here. And thank you so much to Kyle and all the volunteers at the Poetry Project. It's so special to be in this space, and thank you to Bennett for making everything possible, and also to Makiko for everything you've done. And I also want to remember Bennett's parents, in whose honor this amazing award was given. Okay, great. I'm going to start at the beginning of the book with a poem that I didn't know at the time was about Chris having COVID, and I didn't take him seriously, and I'm sorry. The moon. I'd never experienced virtual reality, nor I soon felt had I ever experienced anything so dazzling and hateful at once. The VR installation was called To the Moon. It accommodated two museum visitors at a time, and I'd made the appointment so we could go together. With my headset in place, the room was still there, but my body disappeared. The stool where Chris had sat beside me was there, but Chris was gone. Then the room was gone, and I was alone on the moon. The feeling of transport was real, and the feeling of space, but the attendant had promised flying, just extend your arms, and it didn't feel like flying. It felt crushingly like I was missing out on a major part of the moon experience. There were ghostly dinosaurs on the moon. There was a giant solitary rose made out of moon rock and a donkey that I rode along the surface of the moon. I came to the edge of a crater and wanted to jump, but this was a passive section of the experience. What did you see on the moon? I demanded as we left. But Chris was experiencing nausea. He'd had a bad cold that week, so I'd been thinking about his death, and now the aftershock of my abandonment on the moon left me weeping. What did you see on the moon? The attendant went in behind us to wipe down the headsets to welcome the next guests. I was angry because this all felt like a vision of the future. But maybe that's how people felt when we landed on the moon. Chris and I had both been granted residencies at the museum for our writing, Impossible Luck, and over the days had freely walked through galleries that required no appointment. But with Chris's illness, we'd been sleeping in separate rooms, then going to our separate studios, and now our separate moons, Chris flying and swooping so dramatically you could vomit, while I stayed down on the ground. That's how it was sometimes, living with another poet. Like we could both put on headsets and wave the controllers, arms outstretched and triggers depressed, but for me alone, nothing happened. People say that poets love the moon, but I got into poetry because I liked words and small things and lacked the imagination for fiction. There's a book my dad would read us about a princess who falls ill and won't be well until they bring the moon. It's hopeless. But then someone asks what she thinks the moon might be. A disc of gold no bigger than her thumbnail. So then quite achievable. But what will happen when, moon in hand, she sees the moon still in the sky? It's fine. In her cosmology, the moon grows back like a tooth. The book is called Many Moons. Outside my studio window, dirty snow is piled up around a pool of ice. When I arrived, it was liquid, but it will be an ice rink soon. I've seen them work. They hose it down to smooth it. Now it's night. Two men climb into cars on either side. Their headlights meet across the ice. Now two visitors approach on foot. Tenderly, and not with their full weight, with 1 foot each, they test the ice. The moon is far away for all to see. I'm imagining the poems Chris will write. This is Los Angeles. The work would be about America. We'll move around with open eyes, open ears, and our feelings, Pina said. The dancers had come from all over to join the company in Wuppertal in Germany. Now in LA, they were dismayed. The lack of street life, everybody trapped in cars. Two vans would pick them up at their hotel and take them to rehearsal, pick them up. But they did go bowling. They sat in at a boxing gym and a UCLA basketball practice. They went to nightclubs and drag shows. They heard a gospel choir. They watched the gray whales heading south from Alaska. In Pina Bausch's Tanztheater works, the dancers often make use of common props, break into song, and speak, addressing the audience. These theatrics might seem intended as populist, promoting legibility, but the actual effect can be unsettling. The bodies on stage are no longer attractive forms creating forms. They're people behaving strangely. Movies, a woman cries. I want to go to the movies. A woman gets balloons stuffed down her shirt. A man wears a fox pelt as a loincloth and walks down a line of women in gowns. He's combing their hair. As far as you can see, all this is mine. A man drops a candy wrapper on the stage. It's a common thing how people feel invisible in cars. In high school, in Anchorage, driving my dad's Mercury, I often sang expressively and drummed the wheel. And when, home from college, I learned that Dan had slept with my best friend, I drove and parked and howled and beat the dashboard with real strength. It was what women do on screen. It was instinctual. There, in the seat next to me, I'd taken his virginity the year before. We did feel separate up there. America was my grandparents' houses, commercials during Star Trek for distant Olive Gardens, New Yorker reviews of museum shows I'd never see, and the J. Crew catalog, models in lightweight coats for winter, tailored and non-technical. I too visited Los Angeles and sat in back while others drove and didn't feel I knew it. I'd always accepted movies too easily as real. They overwhelmed me with emotion. I couldn't critically assess the artistic decisions made, had no interest in their making. In Wuppertal, the stage was set with a stand of 7 giant redwood trunks shipped back through the Panama Canal. Several paper houses get knocked down and rebuilt. A woman wears, strapped to her chest, 2 big gulp-sized plastic cups. A man wears, in similar fashion, a plastic clamshell takeout container filled with live white mice. Like you, the redwoods look as though they're underwater. A fiberglass whale descends from the fly space, hangs there like a train car. Was it American, the Times critic asked, 2 young German men after the show. They couldn't decide. At the subsequent U.S. premiere in Berkeley, some picketers outside protested the current state of funding for the arts. "We'll dance for food," one sign read. "Can't afford to see Pina." Providence. The day after we'd met, in a bar where his ex-girlfriend was on stage, I ran into him, asked for his number, later texted the only other Chris in my phone. "Hey, what are you up to?" He was sitting by a fireplace in Canada with his wife and child. I took a train to where the new Chris lived in Providence, cried when he asked about my mom, emphasized my great love for my dad, told him I had nothing going on and didn't mind about the distance, tore up several cocktail napkins and left a pile of snow. Then boarded the train on to Boston, slept beside my childhood best friend beneath a blanket photo printed with her face, a joke gift from her old love, dreamed that in my dreams I saw the future. She had that pink Bruce Nauman poster they used to give away at Dia Beacon. "Press as much of the front surface of your body, palms in or out, left or right cheek, against the wall as possible. Press very hard and concentrate." I told her I doubted I'd see him again. This is called Wuppertal. I'd watched the same program the year before in Brooklyn with a friend. He was a patron of the arts in the moneyed sense, and we had gone opening night, along with several genuine billionaires pointed out to me in the members' lounge at intermission. Could I have identified them on my own? By the shoes, maybe. It's the Rust Belt of Germany, someone had told us, or maybe the Appalachia. So in Wuppertal, it was the same as anything, familiar movements with new people in the roles. The set hadn't changed, the dirt heaped on the stage, sticking to the dancers' skin and sweat-soaked dresses. "They're not dancers, they're people who dance," Pina Bausch. Brought to Wuppertal to direct the local company, she'd overseen a drop in subscriptions. Bausch's works were developed through what many would, though Bausch would not, call improvisation, but once finalized were fixed. But the snapping of the strap of the smallest dancer's dress, I don't think that was planned. In the wings, she tied it back in place. Transcript of symposium, comment from the audience. "What we see in Bausch is rage, the rage of a woman," murmurs of disinterest and dissent. Public transportation there is by suspension railway. The cars hang in the sky from a single rail. An elephant named Toofy once jumped from a train car into the river below and survived, delighting the locals. Days after we rode, a section of the power rail came crashing down. The system was closed for months. At the circus, after Christmas, my niece was unperturbed when we saw a woman balance in a handstand on a plank laid across the shoulders of 2 men riding bicycles along a high tightrope. Beacon. As I descended the stairs of the overpass, glassed in and greenhouse hot, to access the platform where I'd wait for the train, I saw the cars parked in the lot behind me reflected in the glass. through which I looked out at the river so that the cars were, all of them, submerged below the water's surface, wavering. Often, Chris woke screaming. That night, he saw my ghost in the corner of our room. He called out my name, and since I was, in waking life, alive, I answered him. And this, I guess, is sort of the title poem, and that it's about the earth room. A second floor loft filled with dirt up to the windowsills could look like disaster. Inside, the earth is damp and fragrant and feels newly claimed. Bill cares for the dirt, raking and watering, removing sprouts and fungi that might grow. I used to only rake in one direction. Now I also rake horizontally. Summers, with the earthroom closed to visitors, Bill would trench it up, find cracks in the sheetrock, let them dry to be repaired. Now the plan is to stay open all year round. I ask him how it's possible. Who knows? He has great eyebrows. A younger employee tells me, climate control, more tarps. Technically, the New York earthroom, third of Walter de Maria's minimal, flat, horizontal earth sculptures, the first at the Gallery Heiner Friedrich in Munich, opened in September 1968. Pure dirt, pure earth, pure land. No object on it, no object in it. It was installed for less than 2 weeks. Or, if you ask Heiner, it's still there. A sign forbidding photography is being flagrantly ignored. Bill finally plucks up the sign and plants it in the dirt. I rarely feel a natural urge to take pictures, though I have been lately fighting a natural urge to obey. In April 1968, De Maria sent a telegram to gallerist Virginia Dwan. Dear Virginia, many land sensations and projects already realized, so very positive, I urge you to consider closing of gallery and to consider worldwide land operations. The second earth room was installed in Darmstadt, Germany in 1974. One can easily imagine it, Pina with her partner and collaborator Rolf, who designed her sets and costumes in Munich or in Darmstadt, looking out at all the dirt, no markings on it, no markings in it, nothing growing on it, nothing growing in it. Bausch's Rite of Spring debuted in 75 in Wuppertal. Before the dance begins, dirt is dumped on stage from six big metal dumpsters, spread out by a dozen stagehands with brooms. The lights come up on a woman lying there alone. It's called Germantown. It was the year of Mona, Lorenzo, and Hattie, Elena, William, and Ruth. A friend was on bed rest, a friend miscarried. I asked Mona's mother what to send Hattie. I walked to the post office, up through the cemetery. It was the year we'd planned to marry, the year the fabric of the world seemed ripped apart, and so I hoped my dead mom might return. I never stopped. My list of names just grew. This is also Germantown. Sculpture is most pleasing at a human scale. Judd was dismissive of Morris's early objects, but the horizontal slab suspended at eye level does work. It is a good idea. It's the same reason people appreciate deer. In Alaska, we only had moose, giant, impossible to know what they're thinking. White-tailed deer in New York State had disappeared almost completely by the mid-1800s, their habitat destroyed. Tourists in the Catskills went to deer parks just to see them. Chris learned this in a comprehensive history of the region he read most nights while I slept. I hurt him once by denigrating the mountains themselves, belligerently homesick. Often, on walks through the cemetery, I'd surprise a family of deer. They'd run, jumping over headstones to the trees. Judd in 64. Morris's pieces exist, after all, as meager as they are. Things that exist, exist, and everything is on their side. They're here, which is pretty puzzling. A museum, a deer park, a family, a dance troupe, a cemetery, company. And I'm going to just read one last long one, Mars. I ran into her a few years after moving to New York in the stairwell of PS1. She was a performance artist now, she told me, which made some sense. We knew each other from doing youth theater at our youth. Later, I found a video online. In it, as I remember it, she held a pane of glass, dropped it to the floor where it shattered, then undressed, writhed among the shards, and smeared the wall with blood from her cut-up breasts. I resolved to follow her career and created a Google alert. But after that, there were never any relevant hits, which I would later realize was because she had begun performing under an assumed name. We had done youth theater in Alaska, and I was disappointed to find no mention of Alaska in her professional bio. I hadn't known she'd been born in California, and this was the art world standard to give only the year and location of your birth. But surely Alaska had informed her practice, her later interest in colonization and climate catastrophe. She was a few years older than I was, and as a teenager had been generous with me. She once beat me out for the role of Anne Frank. The role was double cast. One girl was Anne the girl, the other was the diary. It was more successful than it sounds. We auditioned in pairs roughly matched in appearance so that my audition partner, also older than me but diminutive, was the girl whom I was otherwise most often up against for roles and who most often prevailed, possessed of undeniable charisma. If we had, in this case, prevailed together, she would no doubt have been girl Anne and I the diary. My early success in the theater was based mostly on excellence within my age group at cold reading. But I was, at the time, closest to Anne's real age and felt spiritually close to her, beyond just being Jewish. The performance artist and her tall partner won out. My double and I ended up as Anne's schoolmates, disappearing from the play once the Frank family entered the secret annex and returning as extras in the camp. The artist carried the show. It was for her, in fact, a return. In an earlier production, the company tended to repeat its successes. She had played the role of Anne's sister, Margot. My older sister played Anne Frank. My double would die young in a motorcycle accident. I attended the memorial held in the same auditorium where we had all performed together on the campus of the local university. The university had loaned the space but had its own fairly robust theater arts program, and I was thinking about it on a late summer visit to my dad, walking through the campus near his house. The air smelled like smoke from fires to the north and south. The sitting governor had recently proposed outrageous cuts to the university, aimed, people said, at defunding climate science, but usually the arts go first. The cuts would also necessitate the closure of rural community campuses, which allowed students to pursue education while living with their families in their villages, and offered courses in nursing, social work, construction management, snow machine repair, plant identification, traditional basket weaving, net mending, whale biology, and understanding the Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act. The performance artist, when I found her again online, had become quite successful, with a solo exhibition at a major museum grounded in inquiry into the potential colonization of Mars, so often hopefully discussed as an option for the continuation of the species after the depletion of resources on Earth and the mining of the asteroid belt. The exhibition's centerpiece was a durational performance 10 days long, during which the artist and two others lived and slept in the museum, in a 3-foot-wide space between two panes of window glass, a simulation of life in a closed ecological system like a spacecraft or a biodome on Mars. The three women had 10 days' supply of food, a treadmill, and a composting toilet. They collected their urine and recycled gray water. They grew edible sprouts. They banged the dishes and danced under red light. The artist called this real theater. If you live on a set, it's not really a set. I had left theater after high school and possessed now no real theory of performance, which I would broadly define as stuff you do with your body. But I'd say that theater is distinguished by imagination, When acting, the actions of your body are dependent on imagined external realities. In our youth, for her performance as Anne Frank in The Secret Annex, the artist imagined life and first love in a confined space while Jews were being rounded up outside. In the biodome, she cooked ramen, she watered the plants, she arranged crystals on a shelf, she took sponge baths, she adjusted the surveillance cameras, she cleaned and swept the floors, she colored her shoes red. She had a few items she'd brought, a special copper spoon. She looked out the windows. She stretched. At the end of the 10 days, the women carried out their waste. The scheduled culminating event was a panel discussion moderated by the exhibition's curator, and the women answered questions from the audience about collective living and isolation. But the artist's behavior was growing increasingly erratic. She spasmed and stumbled. For a while, she quietly humped the wall, and then she was beating herself against it. There was grunting and screaming, sounds of climax and labor, all three women participants now in a violent sexual frenzy. Then they left the room. Thank you.
Congratulations, Rachel. Thank you, Maggie and Jenny and Terrance. Thank you, Bennett. Thank you, Makiko. We have books for sale in the back. We still have hors d'oeuvres and wine, so hang for a little while. Our next event at the Poetry Project is a week from tonight. It's our gala, and we'll have an after party here with performances from Ana Fabrega, Kay Gabriel, and Yaz Lancaster. So I hope we'll see you there. Good night.
Particles existent in the universe would not be engendered from other, more elementary particles, thus abolishing the ancestral specter of filiation, of determination, but would represent the sum total of strong interactions at any given moment. The world as an always provisional system of differences. In other words, the set of particles would engender itself self-consistence. So the emptiness we are speaking of could be summed up as the self-consistence of the world. I'm just going to let that hang and feel free to pull or dangle or blur whatever arrived from that. Now, this sort of following moment comes from an article that is, I think, getting a little bit more into the world of cybernetics. And human knowing, this is the part of the title. But Basarab Nicolescu here clarifies something about the word bootstrap. The word bootstrap strap itself is untranslatable. Indeed, bootstrap in the proper sense, laces, also means to levitate while dragging your boots, which honestly to me sounds like a great way of describing a lot of labor, like it done in certain states. The most appropriate term in translation would be that of self-consistency. So we're now going to, out of the emptiness, recognizing maybe, you know, nestled in to Bart's cute sort of movement toward this idea, that we are invited away from the sense of the need for filiation or determination, that instead we're seeking to produce some strong interactions in this particular given moment, and that difference is welcome here. We are going to, in groups of 3 to 4, write a poem, taking turns with each person offering a word or two. So speak the word or two with your voice and pause a moment as the listener to absorb the grain of it. And then respond to the grain of the voice in the word or words you hear with your word or words. So I'm going to hear your voice. I'm going to try to hear the grain of your voice speaking the word or a couple of words, and then I'm going to respond in kind. Please do, if you're willing, to use this collective Google Doc to record each word as it comes. Maybe you could start by adding your names or the breakout room number, and then maybe there's one person who's designated the recorder, or maybe each person writes their own word. Or the person following the speaker records it. I don't know. Feel free to decide for yourselves. You are welcome to draw from the language you've gathered in your notes and noticing so far for this. But I guess I encourage you to maybe like let your body have the word as you speak it into the Zoom and offer it to your listeners. Okay, so Anna, if you would be so kind to invite us to the breakout rooms, that would be awesome. And we will spend 10 minutes writing.
Laura, just from some dropping out and from your thing, there's another room of two people. There's two rooms of two people. Should I merge them or keep them? Or
maybe we could merge them. Is that possible?
Yes, I can. I can invite them to go to another room.
I love that idea.
Okay. Let me see. Let me just make sure. Okay. I'll just try it.
Yeah, I think that's great.
Oh, okay, yeah. It's in process.
There we go.
Woo!
Okay, wow. This is the best use of Zoom that I feel any discourse facilitator has ever made.
I know, it's like, it's really beautiful, actually. I love the not screen sharing thing. That never occurred to me, but I love the vibe that it's giving.
Totally, totally. Yeah, no, that's really good. And then we have this group of four, which feels really good. I love that everybody went.
Yes.
Amazing. Cool. All right. Thank you for your really expert moderating.
No, thank you for assisting me.
And yeah, I guess SJ, I'll text SJ to tell me when it's time to bring people back.
Cool. That sounds perfect.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm really excited to spend just a few minutes, if people would like potentially to just like say back what happened in your group, slash if you want to just read what you wrote somebody out loud, or maybe if you want to like all unmute and try to read the bits that you voiced, that would also be cool. Would anybody be interested? Any groups be interested? Maybe let's start with like, what happened? What happened? What did you notice yourself trying to do or doing differently or, yeah. People are smiling. I'm seeing a lot of like slight smiling, not to make you feel self-conscious, but I wonder what that's about. So many people are slightly smiling that it does feel like a phenomenon.
It was fun.
What was fun, Laura? Hi, Laura.
Hi. Yeah, it was just fun to be, you know, riffing through each other's minds and where they met and where they diverged. And it was pleasurable.
Good. Good. Other folks want to speak to the, like, what happened? I can say that my group, which was Alex and Parisa, we really took our time, like between the words, like trying to feel the body's response to the grain of the voice. It just sort of happened. Each of us did that. Mm-hmm.
For our group, I feel like there was a lot of like time and space between responses. It ended up being more like a listing, but it felt really nice because the words that we were playing off of each other, like the sensory of that word was in response to the sensory of like the word before it. So yeah.
Cool. Anybody else want to share the experience? Lisa, go for it.
Hey, I was with Jarrett and Johnny. And I felt like physically, I felt like I was on an edge the whole time.
Oh, yeah. Was that good? Was it a good kind of edge?
It was a new edge.
New edge. Yeah. Amazing. Johnny's.
Johnny, do you want to read? Or Jarrett, you want to read our collaboration?
I can read, sure. Let me find it. Yes, here we go. Wait, I've lost it again. Here we go. Call out canter, cut sharp sticks, quick delight. Attentive, quick, silent serpent, circuit slither here now. Soft, softly and pause. After fall, allow the rain open and insistent. What called to me was heartbeat, sending out sand and the grip and the sending out closer to the new into the edge. Arrow says yes to the edge, arrow of attention, lines of windows. I'm back with the rain and the sharp bright of glass. Find your address out of the emptiness, back up now, call out canter.
Ooh. So great. I don't know, maybe y'all should just keep going and just keep writing together. I don't know. That could happen. We're all here on Zoom. We could be with each other anytime, just like this. Yeah, I can feel the edge. That's such a great observation. It's in there. Anybody else want to speak to it or read it? Also, maybe you had a completely different experience. Maybe you just kind of like, you know, trickle tripped or like bounced or, yeah. Curious.
Or we think,
can, yeah.
I also noticed like how much our group was really pausing between each person and really thinking. And it was like nice to just sit in someone else's thinking. But something that I'm thinking about now and was thinking about then is like, what was grounding each person's, like it did seem that each of us was responding to the grain of the voice and the word and everything, but like what was grounding everybody's thought and like what was the logic of their contribution? Because I know I kept going to like what I could see and like sort of the geography of our story and the room, like I kept, you know, first we were outside, then we were inside. and I wondered what other people's like instincts were in that generation. Yeah.
I also enjoyed feeling for the grain being something that I couldn't quite put my finger on, and trying to kind of be with other people also trying to feel for the grain, and like wondering what that, like it was like this multiple levels of like what's someone else's grain and what am I, what's my grain. So I enjoyed that kind of attention to something that I couldn't quite put my finger on.
That's wonderful. Thank you, RL. That's really, I feel like I understand what we just did better because of what you just said. What is it about the grain that initiates a kind of rolling uncertainty that nevertheless has a real motivation to try within it? Yeah. My body feels like it understands, like on some level, the grain of wood in relation to the grain of the voice and the potential for a split, but also the strength in the multiplicity of the arrangements of the tiny and the bigger and the kind of arrangement of those fibers together. I do feel like I, with Parisa and Alex, I like was really learning something about both of your voices by the way that we were listening. And that in and of itself, even sans writing, felt good. Okay. So would anybody else like to read one more poem, or shall we move on? How is this feeling, this like bouncing from one thing to the next? Is it okay? Were you hoping for like a chill night of me just kind of babbling? No? Okay, good. Great. Let's move on to the next page. I'm really excited to read all these poems later. So I felt like we might want to have a moment where we feel looked at by a text or seen by a text. Thank you, Laura. That's very sweet. I really want to babble in person with you someday. I feel like it, like we like maybe sometime we'll like have a real babbling together moment. Really, everybody, I'm down. This Ars Poetica for the Blue Clerk that Dion Brand published in advance of the like emergence of like the full book, The Blue Clerk, is a text that I've kind of found myself returning to a lot. Highly recommend The Blue Clerk, but also this Ars Poetica is such an interesting process document with self-reading and theorizing and offering and trying and wrestling. It's just really amazing. And I think the ways that it theorizes poetry and prose, particularly with respect to the roles that narratives and poetics play in reinscribing, the violence of racism, the history of slavery, the economic entanglements of slavery that, you know, subsist to this day, is amazing. So I picked this brief moment here in the document. I think, I don't even know what page we're on, but we're below the poems we just wrote. The poem addresses the reader. It asks the first question. It is not interested in the reader's comfort nor a narrative solution. It is not interested in your emotional expectations or chronologies. It is flooded with the world. The great interrogation room is the stanza. you are standing at its door. And then I think the word interrogate is uncomfortable for me. I don't know about you, my associations, the feeling of the word. So I do what I often did. I did what I often do, which is I go and I get into good old Edom Online, the etymological dictionary that's just there. And I'm just really curious about the range from like to ask or question or inquire to interrogate judicially or cross-examine. Also to this idea, I think, of stretching out or attenuation that's in here somewhere. I'm not even sure what to do with move in a straight line, but the attenuation, and then this range from asking or inquiring to cross-examining, or like trying to get something out of. So what we're going to do now is we're going to read this. And I think we're going to read this poem, from The Blue Clerk. Folks who did this sort of community poetics class that gathered last winter have encountered this before, but I feel like I've learned more about it since then just by reading it over and over again. And I'm curious if someone in the group would like to give their voice to this, would like to commit to reading this piece. I'm happy to do it, if not.
I can read it if you want.
Faye, I would love that. Awesome. All you have to do is just say exactly as it's there.
Okay. Sorry, you cut out for a second. What did you say? Okay.
I was just saying go for
it. Okay, I'm gonna mute. Verso 18.4.2. Violet the clerk has collected. Violet hand, violet notes, violet coolness, violet edging, violet halls, violet finger, violet region, violet fuel, violet meter, violet breath, violet written, violet hatreds, violet hammer, violet bed, violet wires, violet arms, violet apples, violet digits, violet washes, violet time, violet dialysis, violet records, violet scissors, violet palms, violet onion, violet speed, violet construction, violet fog, violet lane, violet yield, dry violet, half-ton violet, cord violet, violet management, violet sleep, written violet, hung violet, violet suspension, violet carburetor, violet labor, violet genocide, violet mud, violet lizards, violet chemical fences, violet chill, violet intended, violet taken, violet ambulances, violet incarceration, violet shoving, violet February, violet field, violet episode, violet rails, violet reply, violet brassiness, violet blind, violet brick, violet cancels, violet spite, violet profession, violet shame, violet limb, violet smoke, violet chest, violet rains, violet jars, violet pays, violet haunch, violet sticks, violet coast, violet vein, violet teeth, violet gorse, violet escarpment, violet hoarfrost, violet museum, violet ruse, violet recovery, violet creek, violet carpool, violet requirement, violet plans, violet openings, violet empties, violet asylum, violet criminal, violet angers, violet manuscripts, violet introduction, violet terminals, violet maintenance, violet fame, violet probations, violet hours, violet snares, violet whimper, violet officials, ample violet, violet chained, better violet, same violet, violet x-ray, violet becomes, hidden violet, violet blunder, violet early, missed violet, violet itself, violet prescription, scabrous violet, violet thumbs, violet belief, violet riot, never violet, violet spur, intended violet, pinned violet, violet respiration, violet staples, day violet, exhausted violet, grade violet, opening violet, violet gravity, violet help.
Thank you so much, Faye. I really appreciated the way that I felt like you gave each sort of violet manifestation its own kind of space. I think when I read this, I have a tendency to really rush and like almost make violet into a medium that everything else is contained by, but that wasn't how I experienced that. So let's just, I think maybe write even just for 5 minutes. Let's just write for 5 minutes in your notebook. And this is a tricky question and I'm curious to hear how it goes. But the question is, the statement question is, let your attention be interrogated by this poem. What are its questions? What do you notice? And how do you answer? So let's just write for 5 minutes and try to do just a little movement toward the answer to like, what happens when you let your attention be interrogated by this poem? Maybe two more minutes. Okay, I don't know, was that 2 minutes? I think it was pretty close. I guess again, I'd be really interested to just let people unmute and maybe read a bit of what you wrote or describe how you ended up responding to this prompt. You know, what does it feel like to maybe just imagine that your attention is being met by an active force that is maybe questioning, inquiring, but also attenuating and maybe a little rougher possibly. And again, you can also just maybe read a bit of what you wrote too. So feel free to unmute and share. And there's always the chat or the document if that feels better.
So I wrote in my notebook, the clerk does not collect known violets. The clerk collects violet pears that are the familiar things of a foreign world. And I wrote a bunch of other stuff that's not worth reading because it's too thinky. What I wrote, this piece reminded me, made me think of this essay about John Ashbery that Michael Clune wrote in a book called Writing Against Time, where he basically talks about weird, forget Ashbery, forget Michael Clune. I found one of the things that was really cool that happened when experiencing this piece was all of these pairs or the violet objects are not lexicalized for us. They're not familiar. They haven't been ossified. They refer to nothing in particular that we could know from a dictionary. For the most part, except for a few. For instance, opening violet. If I heard that phrase on its own out of nowhere, I would think I knew what it meant. I would think, oh, that's a flower, that's a violet opening. It's so close to something that's familiar. In this context, that phrase was estranged for me because I had become accustomed to not knowing and always having to ask. And I love it when stuff like this happens. I used to write about this phenomenon. I called it de-strangement, when like you have a lot of really strange things and then something really normal happens. And you see it really differently because you've been accustomed to an estranged mode of seeing. And so I loved, and I think it's relevant to think about the word violent with all this. Like I think some of these phrases like violet criminal, violet angers become lexicalized and familiar and known already to all of us. Obviously in bad ways, for multiple kinds of bad ways, if we hear the crypt word of violent in violet. So I don't know, I think this does a lot of like what I feel like poems and poets should do.
I think in a similar way, and also thinking about what Gemma has said in the chat, I was trying to understand whether being swung between different terms by the same term was the same thing as being lulled. And if so, like what the relationship between that lulling is to the swap word of violent for violet.
So when the swinging between terms is lulling versus a kind of maybe a jar, a jarring or a smacking or a hard landing or. Anyone else? I know everyone in here has something brilliant to say about this. And so if they would just say just like a tiny moment of the brilliance that manifested, just a tiny.
I'll read. When I let my attention be interrogated by this poem, I see pictures. I get a color at times in my head. I think violet is sometimes violence and sometimes vocabulary and sometimes weights and measures. Violet is a person. The poem is asking me if I see or notice or have considered the life, weight, heat, and heartbreak of, and I haven't.
Thank you, Prisa.
Sure, a little. I was going to type it, but I noticed that, yeah, with violet, it's just is somehow in this context here and just does not quit signifying. It doesn't like really lose its, it didn't really lose its meaning. Actually, it was impressive how it kept showing how more connections we can make rather than just chopping things and breaking them down. So where were you yesterday? We missed you, information. Oh dear, I was held up because I ran into petrichor for the first time. So this is a rainbow being interrogated. Yeah, ran into petrichor for the first time, all your violet chains, violet cage, premonition, torture, painted gray on gray, Beckett's grain of sky, hell of a field. His attention is floating away. Maybe we should shock him back here. No, that won't work. I was thinking of violence and torture and I don't know. Interrogation, of course, yeah. Being West Asian, I think of like Guantanamo and all these images of.
Yeah. Thank you for that, Alex. I think the sense of the poem's interrogation, like I think that has to be particular, but I felt myself moving toward different kinds of prone positions in relation to the text. I don't know how else to say it. And maybe because of the prompt, trying to submit to them a bit more, which I think is complicated. But I also felt like I was subject to substances. But then also there was this possibility of feeling like I could become active in this haze of the violet in moving between terms. And I felt myself maybe do a thing that I like to do, which is run to the verbs that could be nouns and the nouns that could be verbs. I chastised myself, or the poem chastised me. I'm not really sure. It was like, to what real end is that felt refraction? And like, how could the refraction be action? And that's where I found myself with action RL, and like, to what extent that can do something. My eyes leaping from like body to weather to cruelty, I don't know. Alex, I hope my sharing something is an adequate response to your share. Okay. Anyone else? We are, of course, almost out of time because I can only plan things that are 3 hours long and anymore. I don't know if anybody else in the room has this problem, but I got close this time. It's only maybe 15 minutes too long. Anybody else like to share just for a moment what you discovered when you let this poem interrogate your attention?
I wrote this question after realizing my attention would get, you know, kind of jarred, right, or come back when any like hint of or whiff of a narrative of words kind of like starting to form a story. Mm-hmm. And I just wrote, do you need to be held so badly?
Mm-hmm. 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 I'm going to walk away with that question, Caitlin, in addition to Laura's acknowledgement of the softness as a meaningful measure, maybe even a question, and the question of also whether or not trust is there too. I'm taking what you said about, do I need to be held so badly, along with that softness. I think ending with the Delaney, the little story that's in the PDF, I'm just going to maybe invite you over your bedtime tea or your pre-bed cat loo snuggle, or, you know, you're turning off the lights while you're reviewing this, maybe to just like read through that Delaney parable as a like maybe a response to this moment, because for me, Samuel Delaney is a human being that is eternally open and also analytically generous in every breath, and willing to name the thing while also loving it and naming it at the same time. And the way that he describes this performance by his friend, and the way that he ends with this idea about all the writer's noise is finally an attempt to shape a silence in which something can go on, makes me feel like when we attend to each other really well with our bodies, we're writing. Like there's like a kind of writing in creating that silence for another person. And I'll submit my essay on this subject in 2 weeks time, so that it has some weight and travel some distance. I'm hugging all of you, and now I'm going to be quiet so that Laura can tell us that we can go.
I'm so, Sarah Jane, thank you. I mean, we can go, but also I just want to say how incredibly generous and beautiful this evening was. It was such a gift. I'm so very glad that you broke the NELP rules to be with us this evening and guide us in this way. Thank you all so, so much for being here. I would be so honored if you would consider, I would love to bring together a special publication on the Poetry Project's website to sort of honor and celebrate our time together. So I'll send out an email with more information about this, but I know that so much remarkable writing and thinking just happened, and I'd really love to share that out with people who, for whatever reason, couldn't be with us in the Zoom tonight. So stay tuned for an email from me with that invitation. Thank you again for being here. I would very much love to see you again at the Poetry Project soon. We have a lot of really exciting things coming up. One thing I'd like to note in particular, I'm really, really honored that next Wednesday we'll be welcoming Hannah Emerson to celebrate the publication of her first book. We'll have Farnoosh Fatih and Tyler Ray with us, and it's such, I can't believe Hannah's coming down to the city for it. I feel honored and excited, and I hope that you all will consider joining us there. This is our last discourse of the season, so we'll be back in the fall with more. But with that, thank you all so much. Thank you endlessly, Sarah Jane. This was such a gift. I will carry it with me, I know, eternally, truly. Thank you all. Be well. Stay safe. Have a beautiful night.
Miss you guys.
Miss you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was amazing.
Oh, I'm so glad.
Thank you, SJ.
Thank you.
Yes, love to you.
I am not Jesus, nor have the same initials. I am the man who stays home and does the dishes. And how was your day? Is that woman still trying to do your head in?
Yeah.
The man told me to
I caught you for a while.
Oh, hi, Jenny. I thought I recognized your voice, but it was sort of like I couldn't see you yet because you hadn't bounced to the top of my boxes. How are you doing?
I'm good. It's nice to hear your voice.
Nice to hear yours too. I'm glad that you bopped in for a little bit. This was a hard one to bop in and out of, I imagine, for folks, but c'est la vie. We did pretty well, huh, Laura?
We did so well. And actually, I think it was good. I hung back from the breakout rooms to welcome people when they bopped in and out. And I think that people were very, very excited to arrive at whatever moment. Now there's someone trying to arrive right now, but I'm not going to
Mitchell, I think it's too late.
I think it's too late.
Thank you, James. I really appreciate that.
This really was the most graceful and generous use of Zoom that I have ever experienced. Certainly.
Really?
Really.
Wow.
Really? That was beautiful.
That's cool. Well, I mean, I'm tired of unidirectional Zooms. I just can't do it anymore.
You know? I think this is, if we're going to still be on here, let's be on here in this way.
That's right. Mm-hmm. I'm really grateful. I feel like something will come out of this that will continue on in a lot of directions for me and maybe hopefully for other people. So
I think certainly so.
I also kind of don't understand what just happened. So if at some point you'd like to debrief and
we
just in a kind of teaching feedback way, I would love to,
That sounds beautiful. Yeah. I would love to get to reflect together more. Oh no, I'll continue to reflect on this and everything that I've learned, which has gone in so many directions, certainly.
Yeah. You know, that the moment of people being what are we doing? And then maybe a reason kind of emerging somehow in the midst of it.
I feel like it was also really the case that everybody arrived just quite down. People were not in a negative, in a down, ready to do it kind of way.
Ready to do it. Yeah.
Yeah. People were really here for it. Did you know most of the people in the audience?
I think I knew about half.
That's great. That's cool. Yeah. That's perfect.
Yeah. Well, I should probably go. I have to return to my not digital self.
All right. Well, I'm really glad to have gotten to see you and spend this time.
Same. It was great. More very soon, I hope. And Jenny, sending you a lot of love where you are.
Love you guys.
Love you.
Yeah.
Good night.
Okay, bye. Bye, James.